There's a walk this great unknown. Questions come and questions go. Was there purpose for the pain? Did I cry these tears in vain? I don't want to live in fear. Don't want to trust that you are near. Trust your grace can be seen, though triumph and tragedy. Like this night will never end. Will you catch every tear? Or will you just leave me here? When I had this hope in the depths of my soul. Closer than this breath that I take. You calm the storms when I hear you call my name. I still believe that one day I'll see your face. And I have this hope in the depths of my soul. In the flood or the fire, you're with me and you won't let go. He's our hope. And I have this hope in the depths of my soul. In the flood or the fire, you're with me and you won't let go. Flood or the fire, you're with me and you won't let go.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I ride, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good. The king of
So good.
God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. God,
you're never gonna let me down.
sacrifice my mind to Calvary. Jesus bled and died for me, and I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on the cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed, a heavy stone, Messiah still, and all alone. It trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. It all praise. Pierce the night, and I will arise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Let's sing that again. He shall return. He shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Praise, and oh Lord, our God.
People said? Amen. This time you can be seated. God, today we are so thankful that you said those words. That you said it is finished. That no longer does someone have to enter a room to make sacrifices on our behalf. God, you came as the perfect spotless lamb to once and for all pay the price for us. So today as we take communion, we honor, we remember, and we celebrate those words, it is finished. That once and for all, God, you took our place. You paid the price. And now we can long and yearn for a land that will be our home forever. So today we fix our eyes not on the temporary, not on this world that is passing and fleeting, but God, today we fix our eyes on what is unseen, what is eternal, what will last forever. We long for that day. We can only imagine what that day will be like. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. And I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. You're surrounded by his glory. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? And will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? And will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? And will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall, and will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? And will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? And will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, yeah. And I can only imagine. Your glory, what will my heart feel? And will I dance for you? can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. And I can only imagine.
Just want your voices to sing the chorus, surrounded.
Surrounded by your glory, what will be, oh, will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still, will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all, I can only imagine? I can only imagine.
Long for that day, amen. Amen. Some of y'all can be seated.
Last Sunday, in both services, I challenged the church to get involved in a Bible study on Wednesday night as we open our semester of Roots. This past Wednesday night, we had 460 people attend a Bible study on a Wednesday night in the wintertime. So I just want to say thank you. Keep it up. It's a 12-week semester. You got 11 to go. And thank you. Sometimes I wonder if I'm talking to myself, but sometimes the response is overwhelming. So thank you. Last Sunday, we talked about the sign. The sign that Pilate put over Jesus while he was on the cross, the Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. That sign was hung on the cross, and it was a sign of the sign. The sign was hung on the cross over Jesus' head, but it was hung on a cross that would become the sign of Christianity itself. In fact, what is the sign, the symbol that the world recognizes us by? The cross. In fact, even Islam calls Christians the people of the cross. Interesting, isn't it? It was Friday. And the world will forever be different because of the cross. The Gospel of John records something next that none of the other Gospels record. John is going to look down from the cross and ask Jesus is going to look down from the cross and ask John to take care of his mother. Matthew, Mark, and Luke don't bring it up. John does. That's where we'll begin today, John 19:25. Standing near the cross were Jesus' mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to this disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, this disciple took her into his home. Jesus' mother had apparently been widowed by this time, and Jesus asked his dear friend, we don't have to guess who the reference is, he asked his dear friend John, the writer of the Gospel of John, the writer of Revelation, he asked him, "Would you take care of my mother?" What he's actually asking John to do, listen carefully, I want you to take my place. While Jesus was taking John's place on the cross, do you understand that's what's happening here? Jesus is taking John's place on the cross. He's taking my place on the cross. While Jesus is taking John's place on the cross, he asked John to take his place in the family. What does this teach us today about how God looks at children's responsibility to take care of their aging parents? Anybody want to think about this for a moment? What does this teach us today about his expectations for children to take care of their aging parents. Remember, he is the one that also revealed this in the book of Exodus, Exodus 20, verse 12. Honor your father and mother. Then you will live a long, full life in the land the Lord your God is giving you. But I've got a second question. What does this tell you about Jesus' brothers? He's got brothers, half-brothers anyway. Where are they? What does this scene where he has to ask John, a disciple, to take care of mama, what does it say about the brothers? They were probably, there's some guesswork in this, but they're probably still in Galilee at that time, probably still unbelievers, at least for now. I remember years ago saying that Jesus' brothers were unbelievers, and somebody fussed at me, said, that's not in the Bible. Yeah, it is. In John chapter 7, it's in the Bible. It says that Jesus' brothers were not believers. So Jesus, because his brothers are not believers, perhaps, instead of depending upon his brothers to take care of his mom, he asked John to do it. Jesus would later appear to his brother James. After the resurrection, listen, after the resurrection, this unbelieving brother James is going to get a visit by his resurrected brother Jesus. And this James would eventually become the leader of the Jerusalem church. You're talking about a long way to come. He's leaving an unbelief life in Galilee to come to Jerusalem to be pretty much the head of the church there. Paul tells us of this Jesus' brother's awakening, James, in the book of Acts. That's where we get this. I want to read it to you as we start today. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as the Scriptures said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the Scriptures said. He was seen by Peter. Who saw him after the resurrection? Who's a witness to this bodily resurrection? He says he was seen by Peter and then by the 12, and after that he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time. Most of them are still alive, though some have died. And then he was seen by James, the brother of Christ. And later by the apostles. Last of all, Paul says, as though I had been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. At the time of the cross, Jesus would leave the care of Mary to a believer. That's interesting to me. Not his unbelieving brothers, but to a believer, John. Can you imagine the grief of Mary to watch her son die like this? Here's Mama, the mother of Christ, watching him on this tree. Knowing what? Knowing what she knows. She knows. She had an angel come to her and tell her things that nobody else around probably understands, but she knows who he is, and here he is hanging on the cross. She knows the five announcements from Gabriel. You think she hasn't pondered them in her mind for 33 years? You will have a son, and you will call him Jesus. He will be great and called the Son of the Most High God. His ancestor David, his father David's, God's going to give him the throne of his father David. He's going to reign over the house of Jacob, and his kingdom's never going to end. And she hears that from God through an angel, and here he is on a tree. This is truly the fulfillment of the announcement. Everything in this book's going to happen. This is truly, as Mary is watching Jesus, her son, die, it is truly the fulfillment of the announcement of the prophet Simeon when Jesus was an eight-day-old baby. Let me read it to you. Luke 2:34. Then Simeon blessed them. They've taken an eight-day-old baby to the temple. Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, the baby's mother. This child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall, and he will be the joy of many others. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword. Simeon looks at Mary holding the 8-day-old Jesus, and a sword will pierce your very soul. Have a nice day. Can you imagine receiving that from the prophet of God after she's gone through this supernatural pregnancy, supernatural birth, supernatural conception? He was destined for the cross. Simeon said it's a sign from God. He was destined. Listen, his destination before his birth is the cross. Simeon tells her, up front, 8 days old Jesus, in the joyous moments of holding this supernatural birth child, Simeon says what? A sword's going to pierce your soul, Mary. He's destined for the cross. He was destined to sit on the throne of David as king of the Jews. Even at birth, Mary was destined for suffering. Do you believe that? Mary was destined. It was her destination. She's going to suffer. She's going to experience heartache. Even from the beginning, it's announced. What was it like that day? 8-day-old Jesus at the temple to hear a prophet of God tell you, a sword's going to pierce your soul. 33 years later, Mary knows exactly what that would feel like. The sword pierced her soul as the spear pierced her son. In the midst of such suffering, Jesus is thinking about who? He's hanging on a tree, and who's he thinking about? Mama. Is that amazing? In the midst of his anguish, in the midst of his pain, what does this tell you about the love of God? In the midst of him dying, John, take care of my mother. Was John the only one of the 12 at the cross? In the midst of suffering and abandonment, Jesus expresses deep concern for the future welfare of Mary. The Apostle John records this moment. The one Jesus loves records this moment. And then John does something. It's almost like we go from one verse to the next verse. Everything drastically changes. We go from this deeply emotional moment, John, take care of mom, to the horror of the next verse, verse 28. And Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill the scripture, he says, I am thirsty. From the emotional moment of Mary and John to the reality of the physical pain and physical torture of the cross, I'm thirsty. Jesus knew his mission was finished. Don't read over that. Don't get over to the thirst and miss what he said before. He knew that his mission was finished. This is why he came. Simeon had told Mary when he was 8 days old. What did he say to Mary? He is destined to cause many to fall. They're going to fall, and many are going to oppose him. This is his destiny. Jesus' mission will fulfill the scriptures. Jesus' mission will fulfill the signs. Please don't read over that line. Let me read that same verse, verse 28 from the New American Standard Bible. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things had already been accomplished. What all things? Knowing that all things had already been accomplished. What all things? Because he can't die until all things are accomplished. What all things? Everything written in this book has to happen. And he knows it. And one of the things written in this book that has to happen is he has to say, I am thirsty. And he does. Everything has to happen. The mission cannot be accomplished until everything in this book is finished. Mission accomplished. The cross was the mission. Mission accomplished to complete every word, every detail of Scripture. Jesus knew the purpose of his life. He didn't have to guess. He knew. Jesus' prayer, his prayer is recorded in John 17 that he knows his purpose. He's not guessing. John 17, 4, Jesus is praying to his Father. He says, I brought you glory here on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. He's on a mission. Verse 5, now, Father, bring me into the glory we shared before the world began. When can he go to the Father to share the glory before the world began? When? When he finishes his assignment. The mission must be finished. From the beginning of Genesis, there's been a plan to create. Listen carefully to how I word this. From the beginning of Genesis, there's been a plan of God to create a supernatural race of people. They are called the children of God. A people no longer under the curse of Adam, but a people who have been separated from the curse. What is the curse? Death. From the beginning, in Genesis, God has this plan where he is going to create a supernatural race of people. They will bear the title the children of God. And they will not be subject to the curse of Adam. They'll be separated, exempt from the curse of Adam. The king of the Jews is destined to be the king of these people. These children of God. God revealed it to the serpent Satan in the Garden of Eden some 4,000 years before the cross. Genesis 3:14. Then the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all the other animals, domestic and wild. You will crawl on your belly, groveling in the dust as long as you live. And I, God, will cause hostility between you and woman. You and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. And he, the offspring of woman, will strike your head, and you will strike his heel. On the cross that day, Satan was striking the heel of the offspring of Eve. I want to say it again. On the cross, Satan was striking the heel of the offspring of Eve in fulfillment of Genesis chapter 3. A fulfillment of the curse. But on the cross that day, something else was happening. Jesus was striking the head of Satan. It would be his fatal wound. On the cross that day, the Son of God experienced physical pain, physical anguish, physical thirst, just like you and I, because God made him, the book of Hebrews says, like us in every way, so that he could be our faithful high priest. And what does he say? I'm thirsty. To fulfill the prophecy, to fulfill a 1,000-year-old prophecy, he will say those three words, I am thirsty. What prophecy? Everything has to happen before he can go to the glory of the Father. Everything has to be fulfilled. Psalms 22, a psalm of David. Let me read verse 14 through 18. My life is poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax melting within me. My strength is dried up like sun-baked clay. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You have laid me in the dust and left me for dead. My enemies surround me like a pack of dogs, and evil gangs close in on me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. My enemies stare at me and gloat. They divide my garments among themselves and throw dice for my clothing. That's Psalms 22, a psalm of King David, 1,000 years before the cross. And yet every word of Scripture will be fulfilled. Every single detailed word will be fulfilled by Jesus before he returns to the Father. It also reveals a second psalm, Psalm 69. Another, guess what? Psalm of David. Psalm 69:19. You know of my shame, scorn, and disgrace. You see all that my enemies are doing. Their insults have broken my heart, and I am in despair. If only one person would show some pity, if only one would turn and comfort me. But instead, they give me poison for food. They offer me sour wine for my thirst. Every one of these psalms is fulfilled exactly as they're supposed to be. John 19:28. Jesus knew that his mission was now finished. And to fulfill scriptures, he said, I am thirsty. A jar of sour wine. This is the fulfillment of Psalm 69. A jar of sour wine was sitting there. So they soaked a sponge in it, put it on a hyssop branch, and held it to his lips. Every detail, every word, every promise of God, every sign was being fulfilled that day on the cross. That's why John records these world-changing words of Christ. Next verse. World-changing words of Christ. Next verse, verse 30. When Jesus had tasted this, the soured wine, he said, it is finished. Then he bowed his head and he released his spirit. 6 hours on the cross, and John only records 13 verses. Think about it. 6 hours on the cross, and John, the Apostle John, records 13 verses. The other gospel writers do most of the recording of this scene. But what John did record was this. It is finished. According to the Greek, you could translate those words like this. It is accomplished. It is fulfilled. It is paid in full. What is finished? Do you know? Jesus says, it is finished. What is finished? What is accomplished? What is fulfilled? What is paid in full? We, the church, had better understand how to answer the question, what is finished? Are you ready? Because some of you may be surprised. The Word of God. What did he just finish? He just finished doing everything that the Bible said he was going to do. What's finished? This. It's finished. The Word of God. Oh, there's more. I mean, he's going to resurrect, but he's proclaiming that everything God sent him to do, he has done. Everything recorded in the Scriptures, prophesied in advance, is now checked off the list. One of the last things, obviously, is he's supposed to take a drink of this soured wine. He takes a drink. Lowers his head, says it is finished, releases his spirit. It's finished. Go back to John chapter 4, Jesus with the Samaritan woman at the well. Jesus explained, my nourishment comes from what? You see, they had gone off to get food and left Jesus there. He was weary, the Bible says. He is physically tired. He's physically hungry. They come back with food only to find him. He says this, my nourishment comes from doing the will of God who sent me and from finishing his work. My nourishment comes. He has this supernatural supply that when he does God's will, he's fed. He's strengthened. This is his nourishment. What? The cross. Can you imagine? His nourishment is obedience. On the cross, he's being nourished by God through obedience. This is his purpose. This was his mission to accomplish. They didn't drag him off, tie him up against his will. This is his nourishment to obey God. Many saw the cross as a complete failure for Jesus. I mean, let's be honest. If you're standing around, you've been following him for 3 years, and now they hang him on a tree. Many saw the cross as a complete failure. Why? Because he's dead. How can anybody dying make something a success? The prophet Daniel answers the question. Daniel announces this false assumption of failure, guess what? 500 years before Jesus goes to the cross, before he's born. Daniel 9:26. After this period of 62 sets of seven, some of y'all always wondered what this meant. After this period of 62 sets of seven, the anointed one, who do you think he is? Jesus, the anointed one, will be killed, appearing to have accomplished nothing. And a ruler will arise whose armies will destroy the city and the temple. The anointed one's going to be killed. It looks like he's accomplished nothing. And then a ruler's going to rise, and he's going to destroy the city of Jerusalem and the temple in Jerusalem. How's Daniel know this? The end will come with a flood, and war and its miseries are decreed from that time to the very end. Everything written by Daniel will be fulfilled. Everything written by Daniel will be accomplished. It's unstoppable. The anointed one, the Christ, was killed. And if you were standing in the crowd that day, many people would have thought that accomplished nothing. A ruler did arise after Jesus. And he had an army, the Roman army, and he did destroy Jerusalem, and he did destroy the Jerusalem temple in 70 AD. Do you remember what Jesus said to the weeping women as he was walking toward the cross? You remember? Luke 23:27. A large crowd trailed behind, including many grief-stricken women. Well, he's on his way to the cross. But Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, don't weep for me." Why? "But weep for yourselves and for your children, for the days are coming. It'll be in their generation." And I'll tell you, I got history on my side. It'll be about 40 years later. "Weep for your children, for the days are coming when they will say, 'Fortunate indeed are the women who are childless, the wombs that have not borne a child, and the breasts that have never nursed. People will beg the mountains, fall on us, and plead with the hills, bury us. For if these things are done when the tree is green, what will happen when the tree is dry?" How did Daniel know this 500 years in advance? That a ruler will arise and destroy the Jerusalem temple and the city? How did Daniel know this 500 years in advance? How did Jesus know this 40 years in advance? To give the warning to the women, "Don't weep for me, weep for yourselves, because something horrible is coming to Jerusalem." Is Daniel's prophecy over? I'm asking. Is Daniel's prophecy over? Has it been totally fulfilled? Is it finished? Today, the title, "It is finished." Is Daniel's prophecy totally finished, or have we just seen a preview of that prophecy? Is Jesus' prophecy over? Has it been totally fulfilled, or have we just seen a preview, a shadow of it as well? Do you know the difference between when the tree is green and when the tree is dry? Do you? Luke 23:31. Jesus is being led to the cross, and he says these words, "If these things are done when the tree is green." What? If they would drag off the Jewish Messiah and hang him on a tree and say, "Crucify him, he's not our king." If that would happen when the tree is green, when the tree is amongst you, fresh, what will happen when the tree is dry? Can I insert, what will happen 2,000 years later when the tree's really dry? If they didn't know who Jesus was when he stood among them, who will know him 2,000 years after the cross when the tree is dry? Do you know him? Just days before the cross, Jesus told his disciples this, Matthew 24. As Jesus was leaving the temple grounds, his disciples pointed out to him the various temple buildings, and Jesus responded, "Do you see all these buildings? I tell you the truth, they will be completely demolished. Not one stone will be left on top of another. 40 years later, they were all destroyed. Israel, the Jews that survived Nero's invasion were scattered across the world, called the diaspora. How did he know? How did Jesus know? How did Daniel know? How did they know this stuff? When he said, "It is finished," what did he specifically mean? Jesus is on the cross and he breathes his last breath. It is finished. What's he mean? Why did he say it is finished and then give up his spirit? Can you give up your spirit? Can you decide the moment that I'm going to quit breathing? It's kind of an involuntary thing, this whole breathing, unless you're Jesus. You see, the spirit is life, and when he said it is finished, John says he gives up his spirit. He gives up his life. He surrenders his breath back to God. What is finished? Do you know? The Apostle Paul can answer this simply and most importantly. What's finished? I said the scripture is finished, but what does it tell us? The Apostle Paul, 1 Corinthians 15, says this: I passed on to you what's most important. Sometimes I just want to know what's most important. Paul says, I passed on to you what's most important, and what has also been passed on to me. What's most important that God told Paul to tell us? Here we go. Christ died for our sins. Don't leave out the second half. Christ died for our sins. It is finished. Just as the scripture said, it is finished. It's finished. Christ died for us. He died for me. He died for our sins. It's finished. Fulfilling and accomplishing all scriptures. The payment has been made in full. It is finished. A payment sufficient. Listen, a payment. The only payment sufficient to break the curse. What curse? Death. The plan of God to redeem the world is finished. Just as the scriptures said, the seed of woman has struck the serpent's head. It was a fatal blow. And one day this is going to happen. It's found in Romans 16, one verse, verse 20. And the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. Somebody say hallelujah. The God of peace will soon crush. This is in the New Testament. This is after the cross. This is in the church age. And God has announced something. The God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. May the grace of our Lord Jesus be with you. How? How is the God of peace going to crush Satan under our feet? Faith. It crushes him. When you believe that Jesus is indeed who he says he is, guess what? What Jesus did on the cross crushes the head of Satan. Hey, it is finished. Jesus bowed his head and he released his spirit. He released his life. Do you know what that means, really? Are you sure? He released his spirit. The man, the only man that had the spirit without limit, released it, gave it up for the souls of man. Listen, if you want to understand something unique about Jesus, and there's a lot of things unique about Jesus, but he is recorded as a man, a physical flesh human being who has inside of him the spirit, the presence of God, without limit, infinity and beyond. Inside of him, inside of human flesh. And you know what he does? It is finished. He releases it. This had been revealed by John the Baptist some 3 years earlier. Please don't miss this. John 3:31. He has come from above. John referring to Jesus. He has come from above and is greater than anyone else. We are of the earth and we speak of earthly things, but he has come from heaven and he's greater than anyone else. He testifies about what he has seen and heard, but how few will believe what he tells them? Anyone who accepts his testimony can affirm that God is true, for he is sent. For he is sent by God. He speaks God's words, for God gives him the Spirit without limit. The Father loves his Son and has put everything into his hands. And anyone who believes in God's Son has eternal life. And anyone who doesn't obey the Son will never experience eternal life, but remains under God's angry judgment. Cursed. John the Baptist reveals 8 spiritual truths that were fulfilled through the cross of Christ. Your life, your soul will be eternally affected by how you respond to these 8 truths. Did you see them? I'm not going to go to them in depth, but I'm just going to read through them. In this scripture, in this text, 8 spiritual truths about Jesus. If you say you have faith in Jesus, then you have faith in this. Number one, he came from above and is greater than anyone else. That's greater than Buddha. That's greater than Muhammad. That's greater than any king or any prince or any person. And that's greater than you. He came from above and he is greater than everyone. Number two, he testifies about what he has personally received from God the Father. Jesus says, no one has gone into heaven and returned except the Son. Don't let somebody else tell you about heaven. Don't let somebody else tell you who God is. He alone. Number three, anyone who believes Jesus' testimony will actually be affirming that God is true. What is Jesus' testimony? I am holding it in my hand. Anyone who believes Jesus' testimony affirms that God is true. Number four, Jesus only speaks God's words. That speaks for itself. Number five, God gave this man Jesus the Spirit without limit, and then he asked him to give it up. What? God gave this man, this human flesh man, the Spirit without limit, which means the presence and fullness of God without boundaries inside of his flesh. And then he asked him to give it up for the souls of man. To break the curse of Adam, the one who had the Spirit without limit would have to let go of the Spirit without limit and experience human death. To break the curse, to crush the serpent's head, he would have to let go. It is finished. Number six, God the Father loves his Son, and everything on earth is in Jesus' hands. Right now, everything on earth, everything is his. You, me, everything's his. Right now, there is a temporary king in town, a prince of this world. One day, he's going to be called back into the abyss. But let there be no doubt, it's all power, all dominion, all authority belongs to Christ the Son. Number seven, this is when it gets interesting. Anyone who believes that what Jesus did on the cross finished everything, fulfilled everything, completed everything, will have eternal life. That's it. Don't add to it, don't take away from it. Anyone who believes that what Jesus did on the cross fulfilled, accomplished, everything. It's finished. You don't need to add something to it. And by all means, don't try to take something away from it. It's finished. And by faith in him and what he did on the cross, you have eternal life. But I'm going to tell you what, there's a number eight. Anyone who refuses to believe that it is finished will never experience eternal life, but will receive God's angry judgment instead. That's all in those few verses. It's there. Go read it. It's there. Dr. David Reagan used to put it like this. I always thought I loved how simple he put it. He says, when all is said and done, read the Bible and you'll come to this simple conclusion. All of mankind is either under God's grace or under God's wrath. If you believe that Jesus is indeed who he says he is, that on the cross it is finished, and by faith in Christ, the blood of Christ, the sacrifice of Christ, on the cross, I am under his grace. By faith, I am under his grace. God's grace covers Terry Cooper because I believe it is finished. Jesus finished the work of human salvation. But I'm going to tell you, if you do not believe that Jesus finished his work, that he is who he says he is, and that it was finished on the cross, you're not under grace. You're under wrath. God's angry judgment's coming upon you. And you know what it really is? Listen, it's the curse. You're going to get the curse. Jesus came to undo the curse of Adam. But if you reject Jesus, you're still under the curse. And you'll be accursed by the God who sent his son to lift the curse. You remember that Psalm of David? The Psalm describes the abandonment of God the Father when Jesus went to the cross. That Psalm is a picture of absolute darkness. Why are you so far away? Psalms 22, verse 1. My God, my God. This is 1,000 years before the cross. My God, why have you abandoned me? Why are you so far away when I groan for help? This is in Psalms 22. And who fulfills that on the cross? Jesus. That psalm describes the abandonment of God and the darkness that will come with the abandonment of God, the wrath of God, to be cursed of God. If God is light and in him there is no darkness, what happens? What do you think is going to happen to those who are pulled away from God's grace and put under God's wrath? Darkness! Eternal darkness, outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Darkness! And what's Jesus say on the cross? Matthew 27, at noon, darkness fell. At noon? It's not supposed to be dark at noon. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. At about 3 o'clock, Jesus called out with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means what? My God, my God. He's fulfilling Psalms 22, verse 1. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you abandoned me? Verse 47. Some of the bystanders misunderstood and thought he was calling for the prophet Elijah. One of them ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, holding it up to him on the reed stick so he could drink. But the rest said, wait, let's see whether Elijah will come and save him. You know, they know the Bible. You know, in Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, it says Elijah's going to return. You know what they're saying? Whoa. Maybe Elijah's coming. Verse 50, then Jesus shouted out again and he released his spirit. Notice something Matthew says, records. He shouted again. The first shout was, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? And then he said, the second shout, he releases his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, rocks split apart, and tombs opened. The bodies of many godly men and women who had died were raised from the dead. Can anybody imagine this day? Dead people up walking around. The earth is shaking. It's dark at noon. They left the cemetery after Jesus' resurrection, went into the holy city of Jerusalem and appeared to many people. The Roman officer, now he'd be a Gentile, right? The Roman officer and the other soldiers at the crucifixion were terrified by the earthquake and all that happened, and they said, this man truly was the Son of God. The darkness of abandonment. Why have you abandoned me? Because you know what? Listen, you will never understand the cross until you understand this point. Here it comes. Why have you abandoned me? In that moment, Jesus became the curse. God cursed his only son. Why have you? Because God had to separate himself from the sin that went on top of Jesus in that moment. My sin, your sin went on top of him. He's going to carry your sin, my sin, to the grave. Why have you abandoned me? He became the curse. In that moment, the sins of all mankind were placed on the perfect Son of God. It is finished. The debt is paid in full. What Adam lost, what Adam sold to the serpent, Jesus purchased back that day with his own life. What did Adam sell? Come on. What did Adam sell? What Adam sold to Satan, Jesus in that moment buys it back. What did he sell? Life. He sold his life. Jesus became the curse of death. Do you see God's sovereignty, his holiness? Jesus became the curse of death. And here's the most interesting point today, at least for me. Things happened that day on the cross that are going to happen again. Everybody listen. Things happened that day, in that moment, on the cross that are going to happen again. The earth shook. It's going to shake again. Dead people rose from the dead. I'm going to tell you, dead people are going to come out of graves again. You can't make this up. Number three, Gentiles stood up and proclaimed. Gentiles, that Roman soldier? Gentiles stood up and proclaimed, surely this man is the Son of God. They're going to do it again. I won't be in that group. That part is certain. The things that happened that day on Calvary are going to happen again across the earth. It's not finished yet, not this part. Do you believe me? There's a great shaking coming. The earth shook that day. It says those Roman soldiers, which I kind of picture being pretty fearless, they're scared to death when the earth starts to shake. The earth's going to shake again. I'm telling you, do you believe me? Everything in this book's going to be fulfilled. It happened the day Jesus died, and it's going to happen again. Let me read it to you. Revelation 16, verse 17. Then the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and the mighty shout came from the throne in the temple, saying, it is finished. This is coming again. It is finished. Then the thunder crashed and rolled and lightning flashed and a great earthquake struck, the worst since people were placed on the earth. Oh, I'm going to tell you, the one that's coming is going to be way worse than the one on Calvary's Hill. The earth shook then. The earth's going to shake again. Number two, dead people are going to rise from their graves again. It says that when Jesus died, dead people, ground opened up, dead people stood up, walked into Jerusalem, said, Mom, I'm home. I don't know what they said. They revealed themselves in Jerusalem. It's going to happen again. It happened the day Jesus died. It's going to happen again. They're going to rise and walk upon the earth. 1 Thessalonians 4:15. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a what? Guess what precedes it? A shout. You can't make this up. A shout. What's he going to shout? I don't know. I got some guesses. I'll get sidetracked if I go down that road. With the command and shout and with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet call of God. And first, the Christians who have died are going to raise from their graves. It happened at Calvary. It's going to happen again. Then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And then we'll be with the Lord forever. So encourage each other with these words. The earth shook that day. It's going to shake again. The people rose from their graves that day. It's going to happen again. Finally, number three, Gentiles are going to stand with the Jews and proclaim that Jesus is Lord, the Son of God, to the glory of God the Father. It happened that day. It's going to happen again. Jesus prophesied it. It's written. It's going to happen. John 10, 14. Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me, just as my Father knows me, and I know the Father. So I sacrifice my life for the sheep. That's the cross. I have other sheep, too. Who are they? He's talking to the Jews, and I got other sheep. Who's the other sheep? I got other sheep, too. They are not of this sheepfold. I must bring them in also. That's the church age. We live in it. When God raised up prophets like Paul, apostles like Paul, who will go out to the Gentile world and say, there's a good shepherd who wants you to be his sheep. And it is finished. All you got to do is believe him. And he says this, they will listen to my voice. Who? These other sheep from the other sheepfold. They will listen to my voice, and then listen, here's my favorite. There's going to be one, not two. There's going to be one flock, and there's going to be one shepherd. Gentiles and Jews together in one family called the children of God under Jesus Christ. Are you in this group of sheep under this one shepherd? I'm going to tell you, he is the King of the Jews. He is the Lamb of God. He is the Lion from the tribe of Judah. Revelation 5:9. And they sang a new song with these words. You are worthy to take the scroll and break its seals and open it, for you were slaughtered and your blood was ransomed. Has ransomed people for God in every tribe and every language and every people and every nation, Jews, Gentiles, men, women, slave, free, rich, poor, doesn't matter. All these sheep are going to be gathered together under this King of the Jews. There'll be one shepherd and one group of sheep. Verse 10. And you have caused them to become a kingdom of priests for our God. And they will reign. And they will reign on the earth. And I can tell you who's going to be their king when they reign on this earth. Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Ransomed. That scripture says we've been ransomed by it is finished Jesus. Right now, I can testify, I have been ransomed by it is finished Jesus. Are you in that group of sheep that belong to that one shepherd? A kingdom of priests that will reign on this present earth. That's what it says. If you don't like it, take it up with him. That's what it says. And they will be a kingdom of priests, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years on this present earth. And he is Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. That's what it says. Today you are either under the grace of God. You're in this room today. Here's the deal. Here's the truth. You and I are either under the grace of God or we remain under the curse of God. Cursed or pardoned. That's how I like to put it. Cursed or pardoned. Do you know how the book of Revelation ends? We're approaching the end of John's other book, the Gospel of John. I got only 4 sessions left after today. I'm going to say it kind of makes me sad. Revelation has 22 chapters. I close today with this from chapter 21. I can tell you what's going to happen in the future. Revelation 21, verse 5. And the one sitting on the throne said, look, I am making everything new. And then he said to me, write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true. And he also said, it is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the spring of the water of life. And all who are victorious will inherit. All who are victorious. All who are victorious will inherit all these blessings. And I will be their God. Don't miss it. And they will be my children. I told you that the plan of God from Genesis to Revelation is the same. He's going to create a supernatural race of people called the children of God. And it happens by "it is finished," Jesus. They will be my children. But the cowards, the unbelievers, the corrupt, the murderers, the immoral, those who practice witchcraft, idol worshipers, and all the liars. Quite frankly, that's what every one of us used to be. Come on. We look at that and say, what a bunch of refuge, garbage. That's every one of us in this room. Until we were pardoned. Because we looked at "it is finished," Jesus, and we believed him. And all liars, their fate is in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. Then one of the angels, one of the seven angels who held the seven bowls containing the seven last plagues, came and said to me, "Come with me. I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." Who is it? Who are they? The Church of Jesus Christ. It is finished. Are you in that scene? When the angel says, "Come, I'm going to show you the wife, the bride of the Lamb." Is that you? Are you ready for that moment in time when it is finished? Will you be finished? Will you be undone on that moment? Or will you be just be the beginning of the beginning? The wrath of God or the grace of God, cursed or pardoned, both were finished that day on the cross of Christ. Jesus in the middle between two thieves. This is the story of man. I'm going to ask Chad to come out for the invitation. Jesus in the middle between two thieves. The story of man. Grace on one side, wrath on the other side. Jesus in the center. It is finished. It is finished. Jesus has made a way for us to break the curse of Adam. And the curse of Adam is death. Darkness, abandonment. My God, why have you forsaken me? When Jesus did that, he crushed Satan's head. He crushed the curse. So right now, we're going to sing a song. It's an invitation time. And I plead with you, if today you have never confessed with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you have never publicly stated that confession of faith, you have never believed in your heart that it is truly finished. Jesus did it all by faith. He calls you. He calls you. Let's stand. pray with me. Father, thank you. My heart is overwhelmed with joy and gladness. There's nothing left that we need to do. It's been done. It's finished. You've called us to believe. Believe that you are indeed who you say you are. What happened that day finished your perfect work to redeem mankind, to take away the curse, give us grace. So, Father, I pray that we, as recipients of this grace, would not keep it to ourselves, but we'd be those who you would use by the Holy Spirit's power to show this gospel message to those who don't know, those who right now are under the curse. So, Father, use your bride, use your church to communicate this gospel until that last day. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here.